let's see. And you can see my slides. Excellent. Okay. So I'd like to very briefly talk about the collaboration that I've had the privilege to have with Martin over more than 30 years and talk a little bit about that history and where it's gone. So the collaboration begins when both Martin and I believe were in high school in 1972. Many people have seen this. I thought it might be auspicious today to show this picture given the events of the last few days for some reason, but also it really is important because this opened the gates to all kinds of collaborations. And it was decided that one key focus would be on cancer research. This is a photo about 10 years later of a group of investigators from NCI. The person in the center is Dr. Joseph Fermani of Lee Fermani fame and P53 fame, who led a team of investigators, met with collaborators from China's Academy of Preventive Medicine to set up a number of studies. And one of the first that was set up, one of the largest, was this extraordinary cohort of more than 100,000 workers, some exposed to benzene, some not, in 12 cities in China. I joined NCI in 1990 after having done my occupational medicine fellowship at Hopkins, where in clinics there had seen, unfortunately, multiple episodes of acute and subacute benzene toxicity. As you can imagine, that was still taking place in the Bethlehem steel shipyards. And I became very interested in studying the underlying mechanism of these effects and how to evaluate workers and what kind of biologic markers we should be using to study them. At the same time, our Chinese collaborators were also interested in doing mechanistic studies in workers exposed to benzene. And they actually introduced us to Martin and said, well, Martin was clearly, of all the people who were working on benzene, he was a new brilliant voice, and it was clear that he was the person to work with. So within a few months of our initial meeting in 1991, Luoping and I did some field work and site visits to Shanghai, where we had access to some really outstanding factories to study. And then the study took place in 1992. There was a relatively small study of 44 workers exposed to very high levels of benzene. And we looked at a variety of endpoints that you've heard about described so far. What was particularly compelling about this study was the fact that we decided it was only the beginning. And I remember in a visit to Berkeley with Martin in the late 1990s, we talked about, there really is a need to do a follow-up study, particularly to ask the question of these kinds of effects at lower levels of exposure, and decided to bite the bullet, so to speak, and launched a major effort. This time in Tianjin, which was another one of our cohort sites, because we had access there and infrastructure. And here, not only were we evaluating a whole variety of hematologic and chromosomal genotoxic effects, but we were also making it large enough to have enough workers exposed to under 1 ppm, which was and still is, unfortunately, the regulatory threshold, as well as applying a whole new range of genomic discovery tools. During this period, from our first study to the second, from 92 to 2000, there had been also an evolution in conceptualization about exposure assessment and what needed to be done for these kinds of studies. Steve Rappaport had made some important contributions, and he was part of our study team and did a site visit with us, along with Martin, to these studies and to these factories, and found some ideal factories to include in the project. This is a picture of Qing Lan of the Land Science paper putting a 3M badge on one of the workers. You can see the workplace here. We collected over 4,000 measurements over almost a year and a half. We enrolled 250 workers in two factories that had a substantial benzene exposure, but also a wide range and 150 controls. This allowed us to characterize exposure for the year and a half before and to select subgroups of the population for study. And also it helped us in modeling the sort of very recent exposure, as well as other data that we had to estimate cumulative exposure. The other component of this study that where we really moved things forward was an understanding that with the rapidly evolving range of genomic tools that were available to us and omic tools, that we really now had the opportunity to think about every possible thing essentially that benzene does or might do, and to set up a study with only 29 mils of blood, but processed in so many different ways that it allowed us to soon thereafter or eventually analyze a wide range of different platforms on these samples. We continue to do this. And in fact, almost every one of the 10 key characteristics can be analyzed in one of the vials that we collected back in 2001. So at a time before the term exposomics had been formalized and the term and 10 key and the concept of 10 key characteristics 10 key characteristics had developed and had evolved, we were sort of applying these principles or working out some of these principles together on these collaborative projects. Now, benzene was only the beginning. We then proceeded to work on apply some of the lessons and tools that we had used to studies of formaldehyde and trichloroethylene. Qing led the NCI component of that. Luoping had a major role in the Berkeley component of that with Martin. And then we spent the next 20 years analyzing the data, writing papers, and we still work together. And now we're actually looking at the methylation in all of these studies. We've had a paper earlier this year, another paper that Qing and I were working with Cliona on that on a revision just a few days ago, and also applying some of the same methods to studies Qing has conducted in populations exposed to diesel-engine exhaust and coal combustion exposure. And I checked last night, we almost have 100 publications to date in the course of our 30-year collaboration, which has really been wonderful. I want to close with a photo of this text, Molecular Epi Principles and Practices, that Martin and I and some colleagues and friends co-edited together. It was published by IRIC in 2012. One of the most remarkable things about this text is the cover page. The cover page was conceived of and painted by Martin. Some of you may not know of Martin's painting skills. And what Martin sought to do in this was to think about, well, we have the puzzle of chronic disease, and how can we take both its how can we integrate its molecular components and population epidemiological components together in order to sort of synergize and put these disciplines in a way that integrates them so that we can apply these. And just to finish up, when I was at Hopkins doing my thesis, I was doing a study of a population of wildland firefighters in Northern California and studying a range of biomarkers. And I was told I wasn't really an epidemiologist because epidemiology is the study of disease and these were healthy people. We were looking at biomarkers. I was actually called a toxicologist. And when I met Martin, he said when he had decided to try to move some of the work he was doing experimentally into the human populations, that he was derided. He said he was told, you're not really a toxicologist, you are, God forbid, an epidemiologist. And when we compared notes, we decided we had a lot in common and that became the beginning of a wonderful friendship and collaboration that we continue to this day. And finally, I'd like to say that as the concepts of 10 key characteristics has evolved, what also has continued to evolve is the importance of how to use those when applied to human studies, in very well-designed studies with good exposure assessment, with adequate power, applying state-of-the-art statistical methods. And we're planning at NCI later this year to have a meeting to sort of add some of the yin of epidemiology to the yang of the 10 key characteristics, and to talk about how we might be able to integrate these into and apply some of the methods and newer methods that have been developed to maximize the utility of the 10 key characteristics and studies of human populations. So just to finish up, I want to thank you, Martin, for more than 30 years of wonderful collaborations. You've had an enormous impact on my career, and I've had the wonderful opportunity to work with 2.5 generations of your students, and I continue to do so now. And it's really been a pleasure, and congratulations. Thank you. Now I'd like to turn this over to Qing, who's going to talk about a few results from some of the studies that I discussed today.
So I'm going to share. Can you see my slide?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so Thanks, Marty, for inviting me. I met Marty in 1999 when we started working on our second benzene study, just the Ned talked about. When we had our first meeting, both Marty and Steve Rappaport were at the meeting. and they both had a ponytail. So they looked like twins to me at that time. So for a while, I really had a hard time figuring out who was Marty and who was Steve. I had to pay attention to who was speaking with a British accent to separate out who was who. So over the years, I really enjoyed working with Marty and Steve, and I still do. So together, working with Marty and others, we had great findings and important publications. So I'm going to present a few slides from our collaborative studies of benzene and formaldehyde. So we conducted, this David just talked about the study and the net. And so we conducted a cross-sectional study with workers exposed to benzene and found that with increased benzene exposure, all of the major cells from peripheral blood were significantly decreased in an exposure response manner. Importantly, all of these cell types were significantly lower in workers exposed to less than 1 ppm benzene, which is the current OSHA standard compared to controls. So we then conducted a cross-sectional molecular epidemiology study of workers exposed to formaldehyde and found that all of the major cells from peripheral blood were significantly decreased in formaldehyde exposed subjects. The patterns are very similar to benzene. And Marty's lab also measured the Crohn's monosomy 7 in myeloid progenitor cells cultured from peripheral blood. And Luoping made a major contribution. We found monosomy 7 was significantly increased in workers exposed to benzene. And the loss of chromosome 7 is one of the most common chromosome aberrations in acute myeloid leukemia. So we then applied the same approach in the formaldehyde study. And we found monosome 7 was significantly increased in workers exposed to formaldehyde. And benzene and formaldehyde exposures were both linked to AML in occupational cohort studies. And benzene and formaldehyde both were associated with a similar pattern of peripheral blood cell toxicity and chromosome changes in myeloid progenitor cells. So our study provided a biological plausibility that formaldehyde causes AML and made an important contribution to the IAC monograph 100F review of formaldehyde. So here are the key collaborators on this study. So I want to acknowledge all of them. And by the way, I can now easily recognize who is Marty and who is Steve, even though they both don't have much hair now. So there is an old Chinese saying I have always loved. When you drink the water, don't forget who dug the well. And Marty, you have dug a very deep well for science. Thank you.
Thank you, Qing.
You're welcome.
That ends our comments on benzene. We're going to move on now to a presentation on childhood cancer by Professor Joseph Wiemels at University of Southern California. And then when he's done, we'll have Dr. Cliona McHale and others, if they want, make a few comments. Anyway, let's hopefully get yours up.